got a cup of coffee and we're getting that middle afternoon lunch sort of downtime because we are moving back into the paper presentation portion of the conference today. So this panel is going to be on globalization, conflict, and intervention. And joining us by Skype, and I think it's going to have a PowerPoint presentation as well, is Jacob Kathman, who's talking about United Nations peacekeeping effectiveness in the midst of fighting. And I'll turn it over to you, Jacob.
Did I hear you say you'll turn it over to me? Is that what you...
Yes.
All right. Oh, okay.
So you can just tell me when you're on to the next slide.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for that introduction. I'm sure it was a great one. I have a little trouble hearing you from this far away.
It's the best.
I'm getting a little feedback as well, so I'm gonna if that's okay, I'm gonna turn down the volume on my computer.
Sure.
And then I'll turn it back up after I'm done with the brief presentation. So first, I wanted to thank you for inviting me to be there. And I wanted to follow that immediately with an apology for the fact that I couldn't be there. Unfortunately, the family ran through a stomach bug in the last few days. And if there's any germaphobes in the audience today, like I am, I can attest that today's been a really nice little slice of hell for me. But I'm doing good. It's just that I might be interrupted here at some point with the kids. So I apologize for that preemptively if it were to happen. But thanks for involving me in this. The conference looks really rather interesting, especially with regard to the research that I've been doing with some colleagues of mine. It seems to work really well together in terms of the theme of the conference. And the paper I'm presenting today is an article that was recently published with a couple of friends of mine, Lisa Haltman, who's at Uppsala University in Sweden, and Megan Shannon, who is at the University of Colorado. And just to give you a sort of short and sweet of the article, essentially what we try to do is we try to look at some new data on peacekeeping in a large N analysis to determine if peacekeeping has any sort of significant effect on reducing or increasing the level of violence in civil wars. And so, Kian, if we could move to the next slide. The way we started this project was by looking at the literature on peacekeeping effectiveness, and what we found that for the most part, and for good reason, I think, that most of the peacekeeping research that's out there, it looks at the effect of peacekeeping with regard to post-conflict scenarios. So does peacekeeping yield a longer duration of peace after war? Is it effective at protecting civilians, at yielding some sort of democratic process in the conflict country, reconstruction, fulfillment of mandates, and these sorts of things that generally tended to be sort of post-conflict after the fighting is over, types of success and failure analyses. But when we started looking at the data on peacekeeping deployments, what we found is that most of them tend to be deployed to places where the fighting is still happening. So the peacekeeping operations are sent to hot conflicts. And we wondered if there's any sort of effect of peacekeeping that we could find with regard to ameliorating the initial stage of peacekeeping deployment. So can you help to resolve the violence before you get to those subsequent processes, those subsequent peace processes? So if we go to the next slide there, and what we essentially tried to do in this paper was we relied a good deal upon research that's already been done, a lot of theorizing that's already been done in the literature, for the post-conflict piece, and found that a lot of it was really rather relevant to the initial stage of peacekeeping efforts, which is resolving the conflict initially. And one of the things that I thought was kind of interesting about this question was that, you know, can peacekeepers reduce violence in civil wars, and can they do it oftentimes without being mandated with the ability to act offensively or to provide strong deterrent capabilities to be mandated with some sort of robust ability to defend not just themselves and civilians, but to defend the actual combatants from violence. They often don't have this sort of legal ability to act in this way. So how do they do it, right? How could they be theorized to reduce violence in such conflicts? And what we came to was that much of the theorizing sort of seems relevant to the conflict period as well. And so there's two things that we focused on more fully in the paper. What we suggested was that if peacekeepers are going to be able to reduce battlefield violence, so violence between the combatants, then they have to do two things, essentially. One is to resolve commitment problems between the belligerents. And so imagine some of us have had experience with the commitment problem literature, but essentially what I mean by commitment problem is to suggest that it's whenever you have an environment in which one or both sides believes that the gains from continued fighting are going to outweigh the benefits of some potential settlement. And in that scenario, you have what you would expect to be a continued level of fighting between the combatants. And this is particularly problematic in civil wars. And that is because at some point, for a civil war to end, the rebels eventually have to be willing to put down their arms and somehow be reincorporated into society and maybe into the political process, depending upon what the political outcome of the conflict is. But when they do that, when they put down their arms and they end this situation of sort of dual sovereignty between the government and the rebels, they make themselves really susceptible to the government reneging on any promises that they may have made to get to that point. So the moment they put down their arms, the more susceptible they become, the more risky process they start to engage in. And rebels tend not to want to do that outside of being promised that somehow, being credibly promised that they're going to be taken care of in the peace process. And the other thing so resolving these problems is a big issue for peacekeeping operations, but also increasing the cost of continued fighting such that fighting becomes a less attractive means for resolving whatever the dispute is between the government and the rebels that's the impetus for the violence. And what we suggested, and it's not the first time it's been suggested by peacekeeping researchers, is that there's essentially three things that peacekeepers do or can do to help pursue resolution to commitment problems and to increase the cost of fighting. And one is that they intercede between the combatants. So they separate the combatants on the battlefield. They physically put themselves between the government soldiers and the rebel forces such that it becomes more difficult to confront one another, to engage in battle. And that doesn't mean necessarily that the peacekeepers have to have some offensive capability to thwart violence directly, but simply by putting yourself between them, right? By interceding between the combatants, it can be more difficult to engage one another with violence. And the second thing, maybe the most important thing, depending on your perspective on this, is that the peacekeepers can provide security guarantees to the combatants. I think one way we often think of this is that, you know, an intervener becomes involved and promises to punish one side if they behave badly, right? And by doing so, they increase the cost and thus reduce the benefit of any sort of continued military engagements. The UN might not necessarily have the ability to behave in this way at all times, but one thing that the UN can do is simply by sharing information, you increase the ability to guarantee the security of the two sides. So if you've interceded on the battlefield such that the two sides are separated, you can have a situation in which the UN promises to share information back and forth between the rebels and the government such that, say, the element of surprise is taken off the table, right? The ability of the rebels to mount some sort of offensive against the government and vice versa without the knowledge of the enemy side becomes less possible. And by doing so, you reduce the effectiveness or the efficacy of violence for resolving the political dispute. And then the last thing is you achieve those first two steps in the process, you can begin the process of disarming the combatants. Now, this is something that the rebels especially, but also the mobilization is not something that the government enjoys partaking in, as long as the rebels are still a threat. But if the two sides have been effectively separated, and if security guarantees can be efficiently or effectively provided, then both sides can begin to commit to the peace process such that disarmament and demobilization become something that is more palatable to the sides. And by doing so, you don't just help to resolve the commitment problem, but you reduce the very fighting capacity of the two sides to engage one another. And hopefully, at least from the sort of theoretical perspective, you reduce the violence on the battlefield as well. So if we go to the next slide, one thing that we noticed as we were reading in the, especially the quantitative literature on peacekeeping, was that a lot of the research has some really sort of interesting and sophisticated theorizing, but not always a lot of really fine-grained empiricism. So I think what we determined as we were starting this project is that for peacekeeping to engage in these types of activities, a lot depends on how fully outfitted peacekeeping operations are. What types of tools do they have available to them? How are they mandated? How big and what type of forces are they putting on the ground in their deployments? Yet for a lot of the empirical work, what we were seeing was a lot of simple dichotomous measures of peacekeeping operations. And so what that meant was that in sort of your large and empirical model, what you would often see is just the presence or the absence, right? A dummy variable, essentially. The presence or the absence of a peacekeeping operation in a given conflict to determine what the correlation was between the presence of a peacekeeping operation and the outcome that's associated with that. And I think you can learn a lot from that, but I think what we have determined, if we go to the next slide, that these missions tend to be really rather different from one another. And so what we have here are just two missions on this slide that are graphed, assuming we're on the same, sorry, I can't see the slides.
Yeah, we are.
But what we see is two missions here that over a similar length of time deployed to two different conflicts. And they really vary dramatically. This isn't some of the more dramatic variations between missions, right? So we have one mission to Liberia and one to Angola, or a number of missions in both of those places. And the number of troops plotted over time. And what we see is a really dramatic difference, not just between missions, but over time, the level of what you might call capacity of the mission to deal with the status quo on the ground changes somewhat dramatically. And if we go to the next slide, when we plotted these things against the level of violence in given conflict areas, we started to notice some patterns. So here we have the mission to Burundi. And you notice the dots there are the number of deaths that have occurred in the battlefield between the combatants over time, and then the commitment of the peacekeeping operation in terms of how many troops were deployed. And while you don't see some sort of perfect correlation, but you do see sort of a decline in violence as the number of peacekeepers rose to the mission on the ground. And so we started seeing some of these patterns. And what we thought was kind of interesting, if we go to the next slide, is that peacekeeping missions aren't just different from one another 2 minutes. Well, I might not be able to live up to that. Give me four, and I'll finish it up. Sorry. What we found is that peacekeeping missions tend to have three different types of personnel. You have troops, you have police, and you have observers. And the troops tend to be the more fully armed, police less so, and observers not armed at all. And they serve different responsibilities. Primarily, the troops serve the responsibilities of the types of things that we thought were relevant here. So we have separating the combatants, you had disarmament, and you had security guarantees, which are the types of activities that troops engage in. Whereas police and observers, not as much. So what we were led to was this hypothesis that the more troops that are deployed to a particular place, the lower should be the battlefield deaths in those conflicts. And if we go to I'll go quickly through these research design slides. But so the next slide where we have data and variables, what we did is we put together a bunch of data on all conflicts in Africa in the post-Cold War period, because that is the data that we have access to at a really fine level from the Uppsala conflict data program. Our dependent variable was a count of the number of battlefield deaths in every month between every government and rebel dyad. So one conflict can have multiple rebel groups in it. So we looked at each pair of government and rebel dyad, and we counted the number of battle-related deaths during those months. And then we engaged in a rather large data gathering effort, and that included collecting all of the monthly number of troops, police, and observers for every mission throughout the world during that same period of time. We're now pushing that forward in time to 2015, that the UN has deployed to all of its missions worldwide, and we connected that to the African Civil Wars. To the next slide, really briefly, we used an event count model. The negative binomial is a model that works effectively for our questions here. We controlled for a number of things. And then finally, so we can move to the graph on the next slide. And what we found was that when we ran our models on the number of troops relative to the number of deaths, we found a negative relationship here. So we can, for now, we can ignore the histogram that's in sort of background of this graph. But if we look at the negative slope of the line, what we found is that the more and more troops you committed, the fewer and fewer battle deaths that would occur on the battlefield. Functionally here, I think you might not be able to see it on the graph, but what we got was about at zero troops committed, you would get about 22 battle deaths per month. To 10,000 battle deaths, or 10,000 troops committed, it would reduce to about 6 battle deaths. Now, you might think that that's not a very substantial reduction. So you get a reduction of 16 otherwise government or rebel soldier deaths on the battlefield in any given month. But when you consider the fact that you have, on average in these data, I think 5 rebel groups per conflict, and on average about 72 months per conflict, then you quickly go from 16 battle deaths to several thousand deaths that are avoided, well, ostensibly avoided by committing about 10,000 UN peacekeeping troops, which I think is a pretty interesting result, because 10,000 troops, while that's a lot, is not near the size of some of the really massive peacekeeping operations that we've seen of recent. We go to the next slide. The other results that we found, I think, are not too surprising in one sense, and that is that police personnel are not statistically related to the number of battle deaths. And I think that's not surprising in part because the police are generally not devoted to the front lines. They're generally more in a civilian protection role and a indigenous police training role in peacekeeping operations. But we did find this interesting result that we didn't expect, and that is that the more observers that you commit to any particular conflict, the more battle deaths there are. And we didn't have a real good explanation for this. I think that we did some postdoc theorizing, and maybe we have some decent ideas, but we're open to suggestions on this too, because I think we're still a little surprised by it. So one idea might be that more and more observers might simply be a weak signal by the UN that they're not really committed to the conflict. And by virtue of not being terribly committed by the international community, that the combatants might view fighting as the only way to resolve their dispute. So that could be one thing. And then there's this other element to it as well, where when peacekeepers are deployed, observers tend to come first. On average, I think in our data, about 5 or 6 months before any other personnel start to arrive. And if more and more observers arrive before anybody else, it could be a signal that a more robust mission is in the offing. And if that were to occur, then the status quo would be solidified between the combatants, and therefore the combatants have an immediate incentive to escalate the conflict to improve their bargaining leverage once the UN does arrive in earnest with lots of troops or police. But we're open to other ideas as to why that positive effect might be there, because it's pretty consistent throughout our models. So to the final slide, to the conclusions. I think one of the things that was interesting about this research project was that, you know, I'm gonna end with something we started with, is that we took our data and we had so much variation in it, and we were capturing at a really fine level the differences between and within peacekeeping operations. But when we took that all out and we put just a dichotomous measure in there of whether or not a peacekeeping operation was present or not, we found nothing. Right? There was no statistical correlation to speak of any significance that was present as a correlation there. I thought that was interesting, that maybe we can learn a little bit more about the composition of missions if we study these things at as fine grained level as possible. And then the sort of the upshot is that if properly composed, and if you know, given the sufficient tools necessary to be effective, that peacekeeping operations do seem to be associated with a reduction in violence and civil war. So that initial step of getting from a violent environment to one in which you might be able to produce a long peace or reconstruction or democratization or all the other great things that can come after civil war, getting to that next step is a product of reducing the violence of the war to begin with. And it looks as though there's, at least from this research, this is the initial step, I suppose. At least from this research, it does appear that there is some positive benefit to peacekeeping if they're properly composed. With that, I'll finish. And are we taking questions, or are we going to the
The model that we've been using is we do both of the presentations, then have the discussant speak, and then questions after that.
Great. I'm sorry I went over time.
Yeah, it's okay.
Do we want to alternate that just
so that Jake might have to run. Yeah. Why don't we take kind of a round of questions now, and then in case Jake needs to leave, but then. And then save the bulk for later.
That's fine.
Let's
right,
let's
so
do that.
We're going to take a couple questions.
Okay.
So I'll try to repeat if you can't hear.
Okay, that'd be great.
So, was I reading the graph right that a deployment of 5,000 troops is almost as effective as a deployment of 10,000 troops, but a deployment of 8,000 troops seems to be really bad? Was I reading that right? Or
did you hear the question?
I heard 5,000, 8,000, and 10,000.
So she was looking at your histogram results on the table, where you have some kind of a variation between 6,000, 8,000, 10,000, up and then back down.
So the histogram is just to represent the total percentage of observations for every month that a peacekeeping operation is deployed. I think. What we're trying to show here is that the results aren't driven by some kind of outlier in the data. So it's not that we have a bunch of observations of 10,000 troops, whereas we don't have variation within missions as well. So what explains the difference in size? If that's what the question is, what explains the difference in size there is just the number of observations we have in the data, or missions of that capacity.
Okay.
So the mandates will determine that, and then how. And one interesting thing about the data is that the mandates will have this goal of how big the mission should be, but rarely do they actually get to be that size, at least not exactly that size. Yeah. So the missions vary really dramatically, not just in terms of the mandate that's set, but the ability to attract the volunteers among the member states to provide the troops necessary.
Okay. Any other questions before we go on?
Do we want to give the discussant a chance?
You know,
we can take time. I'm I should be good here, unless you see a little kid's face come right around this corner.
Just one of the other things is that it's easier to keep you on the screen before we transition to the other presentation.
So Jake, I did carefully read your paper, and I'm David Cingranelli. I study human rights. I rarely use have conflict variables as a dependent variable in my work, so I'm not the best reviewer for this piece. But let me say, I think I really admire what you did here. It's very clearly written, minimum use of jargon. I think people from a variety of subfields and policymakers can understand this piece. It's on a topic that I would think should be a concern to the United Nations and also to any member state that contributes to UN peacekeeping forces, given this time when those operations are being questioned and criticized a good deal. And the policy implications are pretty clear in this piece. I think it also illustrates your final comment about how dangerous this kind of work is, because if you didn't measure things as finely and as detailed a way as you did, you might have come up with a null finding and concluded that these operations are useless. Right? So I think that's what you said, and I think all of us who are engaged in policy analysis like this have to be really careful of that. My questions to you, since you're not going to take part in the next session, is since I think the UN should be interested, my question is, have you engaged the UN people with your research project? Have they been interested? Has it been communicated to them? So that's my first question. My second question is, are there other UN policies similar to this that ought to be studied by academics?
Sure, those are good questions, and thank you for the comments about the paper. Your read of it was part of what motivated the research in the first place. We learned a lot from the literature, and a great deal has been written about peacekeeping, and the amount of research that's being done on peacekeeping effectiveness has really exploded in the last 20 years or so. And even, I mean, it seems like a really, really active area. And so our paper is one of several now that are sort of trying to disaggregate what the peacekeeping operations are actually doing when they're deployed. And the types of activities they're engaged in, and the capacities they're deployed with. So I think there's a lot that's being done there. And I think it's all, at least in part, motivated by what you mentioned, which is that we want to. This is the constant struggle with statistical modeling, and that is that you want to have, be able to make some sort of general statement about the world. But you also want to be reflective of reality as best you can be in your modeling. And those things are often in tension with each other. And that's true for this research as well. With regard to being in contact with the UN, I don't know that there is interest. I get this secondhand sometimes at conferences, and I hear from friends who are sort of more tapped into the UN that the research is of interest to some in the Department of Peacekeeping Operations, but I have never promoted the research in that way outside of academia. Although this is something that we're starting through, in particular my co-authors who are sort of more tapped into the policy element of the research. And then the second question was, could you repeat that again?
My second question was, in my field, human rights, there's a lot of research looking at the effectiveness of human rights treaties in producing subsequent improvements in human rights practices. I wonder, in your area of peace research or conflict studies, whether you can think of other policies of the United Nations that could be studied in this way.
Yeah, actually, we don't have to go far from peacekeeping to deal with other problems that the UN faces. So one of the things that isn't represented here, so one of the assumptions that we make here is that, I wouldn't call it an assumption, but that the UN is the actor. When in fact the UN is the representative of lots and lots of actors. And we, motivating volunteerism on the part of the member states can be difficult to do. I mean, if you, I think in the paper we have the graph there of the number of troops and police and observers that have been deployed across all missions throughout the globe, and the line is pretty monotonically increasing, right? So that at least since the early 2000s, the number of blue helmets deployed throughout the world is going up and up. And you might wonder, one policy area that the UN, I think if it doesn't struggle with already, it will struggle with at some point in the near future, is how to continue to motivate that type of commitment by its member states. I think the monthly reimbursement rate for a UN peacekeeper is about $1,000 or $1,100, which is not a lot of money. And so if there are financial motivations for states, it's only going to come from a particular type of state, which is those who tend to have underfunded militaries or to be less developed. And if you actually look at we also gather data on the contributions made by every member state to every mission across that period of time, which was a huge data collection effort. But it was interesting to see, because the sort of Western developed advanced countries have a declining commitment in the early stage of the post-Cold War era. And the countries that have really increased their commitment have been less developed, non-Western, tend to not be democracies that are committing their soldiers for, it's been for reasons that have been suggested to be sort of not necessarily in line with the human rights ethos of the United Nations. So I think one interesting policy area for research like this is not just what do peacekeeping efforts yield, but how do we get more peacekeeping efforts if we want them? And that comes essentially from the Security Council and from the member states working in collaboration with each other. So that's one area I think might be interesting. And if you want the data, it's on my website. You can welcome to have it and take it in any direction that you'd like it. I think there's a good amount of research that's left to be done in this area.
Thank you.
Yeah. So we're going to miss it. We got another question.
Yeah. Hi, Jacob. This is Michael Doyle. At the San Francisco APSA, I chaired a panel on sort of the frontier of peacekeeping research. Your colleague Megan presented a paper which is a follow-up to the paper that you've just presented here. It was very well received, building on the conclusions. But on the same theme that you mentioned, there were other very interesting attempts to unpack the peacekeeping question. Getting old, so I can't remember the authors, but they're from Berkeley. Aisha Bradshaw, maybe, was one of them. And the argument there was that your study focuses on the military, and what they find is that solving other parts of the peacekeeping puzzle, that is the civilian parts, is also responsive to greater investments of civilian advisors. So there's a parallel process on the election monitoring, human rights promotion, rule of law type of question, which is nicely complementary to the kind of analysis that you're doing of the effect of peacekeepers on intra-peacekeeping or intra-war violence. And another very good paper was trying to deal with the endogeneity problem. Endogeneity problem that Per Brommiller argued. So all I'm saying is that your research agenda is part of a similar agenda.
It's all crackle.
Sorry about that. I just made the comment then to this room, and somebody will come back to you later. It's an interesting paper, is all I had to say.
Yeah. Jacob, if you can still hear me. So we're going to switch to Johannes' presentation. If you can just mute your mic, I can leave you on and you can listen to it. And then you can unmute if you want to chime in once we're done with the presentation.
Sure.
All right.
Okay. So, great. Johannes is going to go next. And while he's getting set up,
I'll leave you. So I'm going to be standing right next to Jacob.
Yeah.
The title of this paper is Leveraging International Institutions in Conflict.
So I just want to say very briefly, thank you so much to the organizers. This has been really, really insightful today, and thank you all for being here today. I'm going to try and be pretty quick and pretty short, and I'm going to give you a preview of this project, and if there's anything that you would like to hear more or find missing, just let me know. I'll be happy to share the paper with you or talk one-on-one, so I might go through a couple things a little bit quickly. The question that I'm asking here is old question in political science and international relations, and that's the question of how international institutions can actually help resolve disputes between countries. But this question, the way I'm answering it, is not necessarily pertinent or it's not directly involved the United Nations, but it is definitely pertinent to the United Nations. And so I'll be curious about some of your thoughts, how you see the implications of this work for some of the things that the UN is doing. One of the problems that we are facing in political science is that we have a lot of ideas, we have a lot of theories about what international institutions, international organizations can do to help resolve conflicts. But a lot of those ideas are very difficult to test and a little bit difficult to evaluate because a lot of them work in conjunction. So there's one idea that international organizations socialize states and move states' preferences closer together, but a lot of this work that international organizations do works in conjunction with other things that they do. And what I'd like to point your attention to here is to emphasize some of the economic leverage that some international organizations can have to help states resolve disputes that they have started against each other. And I'll give you a preview of an expanded argument that I have on this issue, and then also I'll show you some data that lend some credence to this claim. The kinds of cases that I'm dealing with here in this part of the project, at least, are illustrated by this particular example here. States frequently make claims to worship each other that can come in the forms of claims over territory, for instance. Guatemala and Belize have a fairly long-standing dispute about a particular piece of territory that the two countries have been disagreeing over who this territory belongs to, and that there are various ways that those two countries are trying to resolve this issue. Now, of these claims, we observe several hundreds, or we have observed several hundreds since World War II, and the some of the answers, as I just said earlier, that we have to how states can resolve those claims with the help of international organizations relate to a couple of ideas. International organizations can socialize states and hopefully make them friendlier to each other. International organizations can mitigate information problems between countries, and international organizations, of course, can engage in dispute resolution through the International Court of Justice, for instance. But I'd like to highlight a particular other aspect that international organizations can use to help states resolve disputes, such as that claim that you just saw. And that particular aspect relates to something that Jake was just mentioning earlier, and that is the problem of commitment that states are facing when they're negotiating over such disputes. When states face commitment problems, it's difficult for them to stick with a peaceful resolution of a conflict because there are various opportunities, various possibilities that states might remain from that kind of commitment down the road, down in the future. And so I'm particularly interested in here why states can sometimes end up coming to a peaceful bargain over an issue despite such commitment problems and not even start fighting, whereas Jake was talking about ending fighting in civil wars. For that, I've found a couple of interesting aspects that international organizations care about, even though a group or a whole sector of international organizations is actually not even tasked with conflict resolution. So the international organizations that I'm talking about here are mostly economic organizations, such as the World Bank, other development banks, some trade organizations, some regional trade organizations. They perceive militarized conflict, violent conflict between states, as really harmful for their projects. If you talk to project managers, country directors at the World Bank, they are very concerned about militarized conflict because it destroys investment from the institution, makes it very difficult for the institution, for the organization to operate. Conflict also threatens macroeconomic stability and economic growth, hampers growth substantially in most cases. And a lot of international organizations that deliver economic aid or that deliver economic benefits have developed safeguard policies that try to keep those international organizations out of disputed issues. The World Bank, for instance, has safeguards on disputed territories. So disputes between countries, claims like the ones that I just showed you, are really problematic for those organizations, so not very desirable. At the same time, some international organizations also have considerable leverage over member states, leverage that comes in the form of benefits that those institutions can withhold or that they can distribute. It comes in the form of program assessments. So international institutions can assess programs in a certain way, and if member states present some problems in terms of the implementation of those programs, then organizations can withhold these benefits. And one particular aspect that I'd like maybe to have a little bit of a conversation about later is how much international organizations, governmental organizations, actually serve as vanguards for other organizations that might follow in their assessment of countries' situations based on the judgment that IGOs make. And the leverage that I identify in some international organizations here comes in the form of clear rules for engagement, like safeguards that I just mentioned. It comes in the form of the publicity of sanctions or suspension of benefits or promise of benefits from those organizations. So those are very public costs, very public statements. A little bit different from bilateral diplomacy, for instance, when, say, the United States is sending some signals to the Egyptian government, for instance, or the Pakistani government, to tone down some military actions, for instance, towards India or so. So this kind of leverage that I see here really changes incentive structures among states that are engaged in a dispute. Changes the incentive structures away from escalating a conflict towards trying to resolve that conflict. Because if the conflict is not resolved, then those states, those countries, might face some severe problems or some severe sanctions from these organizations. So this kind of leverage, I argue in the paper, creates consequences and affects directly the commitment problem that states are facing when they're bargaining over disputed territory, over disputes in general. And that argument, and again, this is something that I developed in much more detail with some case study insight from some interviews that I did at some of those organizations, and that has a pretty clear empirical implication that I should observe much less probability or a much lower probability of disputes turning into wars, turning into conflicts, when institutions, international institutions with leverage, actually have ties to the states that are involved in that dispute. I'm going to show you some brief information about the IGOs that I consider, or that I coded or identified as having leverage, and then I'm going to show you some of the empirics here. The key elements that I've identified as being crucial for leverage that IGOs can have to do with institutional structure, partially something that we heard a little bit over lunch, how institutions make decisions, whether decision-making is delegated to an institution or whether an institution depends on consensus decisions among the members. It depends on whether institutions actually distribute tangible benefits to member states or whether institutions are mostly a talking forum. And also, it depends on clear, expressed statements of the institutions that they do see direct problems that come with militarized conflict among member states. And with those criteria in mind, I've coded international organizations, whether they have small, medium, or high degrees of leverage of this kind, and I've then evaluated how many states, pairs of states that have expressed claims, have expressed disputes with each other, how many of these states are actually both engaged in these kinds of international organizations. And that's the kind of data that we're seeing here. So we see that many of these states are members in a couple of these international organizations. Some of them, however, also are members in a larger number, 4, 5, 6, 7, or 8, or 9 in this particular case. So this is the data that I'm working with here. And then I have a number of empirical investigations where I investigated or where I checked whether these kinds of associations actually correlate with the use of violence, with the use of force in claims like the one that you saw at the onset here of the presentation. And what I do see is that the more memberships or the more connections, the more ties countries have within international organizations that have such leverage, the lower the likelihood is that they're going to use force during one of those claims. The reduction here is pretty strong. So countries that are not at all connected through any of those institutions have a pretty high, or face a pretty high probability of using force in those claims, but once you have three, four, five, or more of those memberships in common, then the probability of actually resolving a claim through force is pretty low. What I also do in this project is I don't just stop here, but I also compare this kind of relationship to the other mechanisms that we usually associate with international organizations and conflict resolution. So socialization, whether international organizations just generally make states, move states closer in terms of their identity, or also whether international organizations reveal information about things like military capability or preferences. And I'm just going to show you some very good results here where you can see that by far, or definitely the largest and the most substantial impact that I see here comes from the international institutions that I've identified here as having leverage. So each of these dots here shows you the average reduction in the probability of using force in the cases that I just discussed. And each of those three lines here shows you different groups of international organizations that represent different institutional mechanisms. And each of those dots here comes from a different empirical specification. So I've used a variety here of empirical specifications. What you can also see, but I don't want to necessarily go over that, are some other determinants of why states actually use force in these claims. And the main purpose of what I just want to show here is that the rest of my investigation is pretty much consistent with what we would expect anyway. So the takeaway, and maybe a little bit of a discussion opener later on, or in a couple of minutes, is that in claims, in disputes over territory, and also in other kinds of international interactions that can end up in war, such as international crises, another part of this project that I'm not explicitly talking about here. In those kinds of situations, we can see that there is a robust relationship between states' engagement in or embeddedness in international organizations that have economic leverage over them, and a lower chance of states using violence in such claims. And that can be shown not just in terms of the correlation study you just saw, but it can also be shown if we take into account that maybe friendlier states are more likely to join those kinds of organizations. So even if we account for that, I still see that relationship. There's not a lot of evidence for IGOs with leverage screening out possibly disputatious states, states that might have hostile relations. So the empirical evidence here is pretty robust. But there's still a lot that I think needs to be figured out, and I think there's also still a lot that just lends itself to learning more about the kinds of dynamics through which international organizations actually help states resolve conflicts. One of those issues is whether international organizations can create audience costs. Audience costs are one concept or one phenomenon in international relations where international organizations help governments to commit to a particular choice by making it costly for them to renege from that choice. And one way to that the cost could possibly enter the calculus of governments is through the influence of the kinds of international organizations that I just talked about. And for doing that, I'm planning a survey experiment that tries to test a couple of different mechanisms that we know from international relations theory that should drive the influence of international organizations. And in that case, the cost-based mechanism that I talked about here will be one, or would be one of the potential mechanisms that I'm investigating. I've also looked at this in different contexts, slightly different contexts, in states that are engaging in rivalries and long-term disputes, whether I observe the same kind of dynamic here, whether once states actually enter or subject themselves to the influence of those organizations' leverage, whether those rivalries change, whether they're likely to terminate, or whether they're less likely to resume. And I do find that as well. So in a more critical context, I do see the same kind of evidence. But for the discussion here, I think a couple of things that I'd like you to maybe think a little bit about, or maybe also let me know what your immediate reactions is. Part of what this project does, it clarifies or it adds a little bit of knowledge to how we understand the role of international institutions in interstate disputes, given that there are some challenges to actually identifying what that role is. It also highlights that international institutions that are not directly tasked with conflict resolution, so not mediators, not international courts, not the UN, but organizations like the World Bank, regional development banks, trade organizations, that sometimes are actually explicitly apolitical. So if you speak with representatives from economic organizations, one of the things that they are pretty likely to say first when I ask them about militarized conflict, when I ask them about political disputes between member states, that's something that is very far away from their task. It's something that they're not directly tasked with, of course. But despite that, the conditions under which these institutions operate might have some pretty clear, have some pretty direct impact, some pretty direct implications for militarized conflict and for conflict within member states, between member states and also within member states. The parting thought here that I wanted to especially throw out to the group here is how much we can observe an increase in leverage, and the kind of leverage that I talk about here, as governance networks become more dense. So as organizations coordinate their actions in a more direct manner. So 20, 30 years ago, different organizations, different institutions had their own rules of engagement, had their own projects pretty much, or had their own projects working a little bit more in isolation. But much more recently, there's much more exchange between those institutions. Institutions learn from each other too. So from my end here, I would expect that the increasing density of governance networks is also going to increase the kind of leverage that those organizations have. And that should also shape increasingly the way how states resolve disputes. I'm going to end here. And as I said, any thoughts you have will be very appreciated. And sorry, Jake, I was walking around in front of you.
Should we? Yeah. Wait, so yeah, did you want to take
it? Yeah.
Is he on?
Yeah, he can unmute his mic if he wants to talk.
I do have a few comments and questions. Jake, can you hear me?
I can.
You can, okay. So this is really an interesting paper. I don't know how many people got a chance to read it. It's quite different from Jake's paper because it's in an earlier stage of development, whereas Jake's paper has been polished, I think, over a considerable period of time and is now published. So the advantage is we can have some constructive criticism and maybe help with the final version of this paper. I think it's... So its main purpose is to build theory, I would say, not to inform policymakers. So I don't know if there are policy implications to this. Maybe you can address those in a minute, but I think mainly it's to help us understand how memberships and ICOs might make states less likely to be involved in conflict. It's relevant to the United Nations because these leveraging institutions, IGOs, were creations of the UN, either directly or indirectly. I'm not certain that's who the IMF and the World Bank were. And of course, the UN is one of its main goals is to avoid war. Arguably, its main purpose was it was created to avoid war. So it's very relevant to what we're talking about today. I had some prejudices because I have studied the effect of the IMF and the World Bank on human rights and conflict. And my own argument is that these institutions which give up money are often governed by neoliberal principles, which end up causing hardships for the poorest people in society and lead to discontent, protest, rebellion, and eventually to repression in, under some circumstances. Now you, and as I read the 2011 World Bank Development Report that you cite commonly in your paper, it's internal civil conflict that is really the centerpiece of that report. And they're as concerned about organized criminal violence and internal civil conflict, but you choose to totally ignore that. And I think it's okay, but I think you should say that I'm just going to put this to one side, I'm only going to focus on interstate conflict, but at least acknowledge that there's a literature out there that would claim that the activities of these organizations, or at least some of them, may contribute to the very kind of conflict that they say hurts development projects. The second thing I would say to you is that I kept searching for examples, right, that would convince me that, yeah, you know, what he's talking about, I can remember that. Sort of like the examples we got in the previous paper where we know about these peacekeeping operations, we know about the ones in Rwanda and other places, and so they come to our attention. But the examples you used, in my opinion, were not compelling. I mean, we can go through them, but I won't do that. I won't take a lot of time. An example of a case where the directorate of one of these IGOs actually attempted to mediate a potential conflict and succeeded in avoiding it, to me, would have been very useful. And if you can find that kind of example, I think it would really help that paper. And I think there may be an endogeneity problem in the sense that the countries that are members in lots of these organizations may also have a commitment not to go to war. So you're, four of the IGOs you mentioned are European. And you know, the literature shows that democracies tend not to fight against each other. And I would at least think about that and mention it if you want to dismiss it. And I also, since these organizations give money out, I think, in every case, you'd call it tangible, okay? So assume that's financial. Then you talk about joint memberships, but you don't differentiate between donors and potential recipients. And I would think that these organizations have way more leverage over potential recipients than they do over donors. That concludes my question.
Thank you.
Do you want to respond to that, or do you want to take a few questions and maybe respond to it?
If there are questions, I'd gladly take them.
Do we have any questions?
I have more comments. So you concluded with a bit of a request for how to move forward in a particular way, and I think what you were asking for was, in a sense, you've done a crude social network analysis. You could do it a more elaborate social network analysis. And I think what you were describing would be eigenvector centrality, where you are getting not all organizations are going to be treated the same. The organizations that have, that are more centrally important in the IGO world are going to be having connections to those, or having mutual connections to those, would be weighted more strongly. So that might be able to get you toward a little bit more of that nuance that you were, I think that's what you were requesting. And there are, and if you, I know, so R is free and makes beautiful graphs, but I don't find it particularly user-friendly. UCINET is wonderful. That's where my spider web of international trade graphic came from.
I've got a comment, and it comes back to leveraging global networks, and I was thinking about this, and it was building up as you were giving the presentation, but then it crystallized towards the end there, and this whole issue of kind of organizational density, and it brought back to mind, for me, a book by Harold Jacobson, Networks of Interdependence, and I'm trying to remember, like, maybe it can be so long ago, but, you know, part of the argument was talking about just the numbers of IGOs and INGOs as well, but more so just the number, the density, and this issue of membership, and that it has this, I don't know if you hooked into Jacobson's argumentation, if that has been there. And then I couldn't help also thinking about Shays and Shays on compliance, because again, it's this issue of, well, states, yeah, you know, by right, they shouldn't comply. They don't have the interest, if you look at individual, but it adds up to this issue of being members of the international community. And there's part of doing things that they might not otherwise, do, except that they're all the reputational, they're all the other side effects, if you will, or secondary consequences that just are enough to tip than in making the right choice.
Thanks. So I don't want to take much time with responding. So I think should I take a couple minutes and then we can see if we move on to the last.
Sure.
Panel.
Sure.
So thank you all for your comments. I just want to say very briefly, because David brought it up, the role of those organizations in internal conflicts and civil wars. It's actually something that I'm also really interested in. It's something that I've published on before, and where I'm working a book manuscript right now, where I find that the kind of concern that the World Bank, for instance, has expressed in the 2011 World Development Report, does resonate in a similar kind of dynamic as I've described here over longer terms, because the kind of influence that the bank and other organizations exercise over member governments is for some countries, and you were mentioning whether it matters what level of engagement the bank, for instance, has, whether this is a country that is receiving a lot of aid from the bank or just not a lot. But if that is present, so if the bank is really engaged in a country, it also does give the bank and other institutions leverage. And that can actually push governments towards acting more accommodating towards demands from opposition groups and can help resolve conflicts that way. So I see very much the concern about the neoliberal policies in the past that have created conditions for protest and revolt, but I also think that we should not ignore the fact that the bank does have a strong, other organizations do have a strong interest in membership countries not dissolving in violence, and they do exercise that influence. I would argue that.
So my point is not that there's anything wrong with that argument, but I think for some people, ignoring that whole literature when you have command of it is a mistake, because it raises an antenna that says, wow, what else is really going to happen that we ought to know? So I think you should acknowledge it and put it to one side and then move on.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's right.
Footnote this book.
No.
Yeah. I also think that a key question I didn't talk about in the presentation at all, that's something that also came to my mind during Jake's presentation too, is this question that you labeled it heterogeneity, right? So where are we, what kind of inference can we take away from this correlation that we see here, whether it be in my case with memberships and organizations, or it be in Jake's case with the decrease in battle deaths once or maybe as peacekeepers are deployed. And the way I am approaching in this paper here is that I'm only studying the kinds of cases where states actually have already expressed disagreement. So this is not situations where the US and Canada are just never even fighting. Those are cases where countries have expressed that they are willing to publicly engage in dispute with another country. And that, to me, suggests that this is less of an heterogeneity issue that you mentioned. This is less of a problem possible. But it depends, of course, on how convincing it is.
Yeah, I don't know. I'd have to go back and read it again. I mean, the chart suggests that we have 7 or 8 joint memberships in these organizations. It has a much bigger effect. And I just wonder about who joins these organizations. And is it possible that there's a selection of peace-loving countries joining more than conflict-prone countries?
Yes, absolutely. And so I can't account for that econometrically, or I do account for that econometrically. But I agree that this is still an issue that, where, as you were saying, examples and a narrative is certainly in some ways more helpful. As far as it's possible empirically, I'm addressing it. But I do agree that in some ways a narrative is at least equally convincing now. And then, Kristen, thank you for the network analysis mentioning. So another part of this project, I do use network analysis to identify leverage, not in terms of just joint memberships, but in terms of what institutions have. High centrality, that's very well taken away. Digging that area. Yeah.
I'm just curious, the way you set up the analysis is to simply look at the density of membership, the number of memberships. Is there a way to fine-tune the analysis so that you're actually looking at dependency relationships?
Mm-hmm.
To what extent are there external debts to these institutions? To what extent would that then impact the leverage of these institutions? I don't know if you're doing it
I'm planning to do, but it requires a lot of work. So it's something I haven't been able yet, right? But what that ideally would be for me is how much engagement does the organization have in that country in a given year? So that could be loan disbursements, it could be promises of loans or commitments, and that data is available, right? And so that would give you certainly a much more tangible or some ways a much more detailed measure of the actual influence and of the actual leverage, right? If you think about the bank having maybe just a couple of projects that are worth $5 million in particular country compared to a $2 billion dam, that probably
the size
of the economy, absolutely. Yeah.
It sounds like a very interesting paper to me. I couldn't pick up what are the controls that you're using on the study of IOs and conflict. That would be one question.
Mm-hmm.
And with regard to the democracy factor, O'Neill and Russet find that IOs have a very small but still significant additional impact on reducing the escalation from dispute to actual conflict in states to the extent that they become more democratic. But a key thing would be what controls that you're putting on the test that you're doing.
Mm-hmm. So I could flip back, but I can also just tell you. So democracy and trade, other types of international organizations, how salient the claim is. So is this an issue, is this a territorial claim, or is it a claim over maritime issues, which is a little bit less salient. The power differential between countries, so are those two equally powerful countries, or are those one very powerful country versus a weak country. Economic capabilities.
A region, you have a region variable in there?
I use random effects for regions, so I allow the regions to vary.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think that's about it. I said salience, right? Yeah.
And you still find a significant effect for the IO measurement,
right,
as the number of IOs go up with all those controls.
Yeah.
That sounds interesting.
Yeah, so okay, so here he was, and this is, repeating basically what I just said, the salience and democracy, as you mentioned, and also whether those countries were engaged in a rivalry before.
Mm-hmm.
So the impact of democracy here is a little bit smaller. So those are all on the same scale here. Democracy is a little bit smaller, and depending on model specification, the probability that there's an effect is a little bit lower.
Mm-hmm.
So those are all Bayesian estimates, so those are all posterior probabilities there. So left to the blue line indicates an effect.
So what you're measuring is the escalation from dispute to actual conflict,
yep.
or from
dispute to conflict,
but not the generation of a dispute.
That's right.
Okay.
How prevalent is it?
The escalation?
Yes.
In about 1/3 of cases. Yeah. So the evidence that I'm showing you here is from these claims. I repeat the same thing also for prices, because I wanted to make sure that claims are not maybe too low of a threshold, right? So I also use this on crises that involve expressions of disagreement and also some sable rattling, essentially. And there it's also about 1/4, but I get about the same.
Okay. Well, let's thank Johannes and
Thank you all.
Okay.
Thank you.